Hello and welcome to episode 11 of Terrain Rendering. The topic for today is the Skybox technique. Up until this point, we've only been rendering the terrain mesh, so all the remaining pixels simply get the default color of the frame buffer, which we can change by calling glClearColor. We can use various colors to mimic the sky, but obviously it will be much better to get some nice texture which actually looks like the sky. This is where the skybox comes in. It is literally a box created from 12 triangles and a special type of texture which, when wrapped around the box, causes the faces of the box to match perfectly along the joint edges. You can find many resources online with beautiful skybox textures for your games. So how do we render a skybox? Before we get into that, I'd like to say a big thank you to Unco Man, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. When we render a regular 2D texture, we use a texture coordinate with two components, usually called UV, that correspond with the X and Y axes, respectively. In complex models, the texture coordinates are assigned to each vertex using the modeling software in a process called UV unwrapping. In the case of a square, for example the face of a skybox, it's very easy to assign the texture coordinates yourself by going from 0,0 at the bottom left corner to 1,1 at the top right. But this means that we have the same set of texture coordinates for every face of the skybox. After all, they are all squares. How do we know which of the six faces to sample from? It's pretty obvious that as the camera turns around, the final frame will include pixels from several faces. The solution is provided by OpenGL. To render the skybox, we use a special type of texture called the Cubemap, which contains six 2D textures. Each texture is assigned to the positive or negative direction of the X, Y, and Z axes. The box has 8 vertices and their position vectors go from -1, -1, -1 up to 1, 1, 1. We can send this vector from the vertex shader to the fragment shader, and during rasterization it will be interpolated across the face of each triangle. OpenGL provides a special type of uniform to sample from cube maps called sampler cube. When we sample from the sampler cube, we provide a 3D vector instead of 2D. Sampling here is a two-step process. First, OpenGL selects the face that corresponds to the component of the 3D vector with the largest magnitude, and then the other two components are used as standard UV coordinates for 2D sampling from that face. Let's see an example. Here we have a 2D diagram of the X and Y axes, and two direction vectors, 0.2 on the X and 1 on the Y, and -1 on the X and 0.2 on the Y. In the case of the first vector, the largest magnitude belongs to the positive Y axis, so this is the chosen face and X will be used for sampling along that edge. In the case of the second vector, the largest magnitude is the negative X, so the Y is used for sampling. The same concept is extended to 3D as well. Now you may notice a problem here. Texture coordinates usually go from 0 to 1, but in this case the range is actually -1 to 1. Don't worry, OpenGL will automatically map this to the correct range by adding 1 to the two remaining components and multiply by half. Now let's see how to load the cube map. To load and maintain the cube map, I have a class called CubemapTexture. This class has a handle for the texture, like any other texture in OpenGL. When we create the cube map, we provide a directory where the six images are stored. And we provide their file names for the positive and negative X, Y, and Z. To create a file name for each face, we just need to concatenate the base directory with the file name. Very simple. Now there is an array here with the enums for the six faces. And as you can see, their values are consecutive. So it's very easy to loop over the six faces and just add the current index in the loop to the first one. So to load a cube map, we generate a handle for the texture, as usual, using GL gen textures, and we need to bind it to a special target called GL texture cube map. Okay, so this is instead of the regular texture 2D that we are familiar with. Now we loop over the array of types that we saw here, this one. We load the image using STB image, as usual, and we call GL text image 2D, passing in the current enum of the face from the array of types. Here's the data. And in this case, the format is RGB, and we have an unsigned byte for each channel. Now we need to set up some parameters for the texture, such as the magnification filter and the minification filter. We use GL linear here. And we also set up the wrapping modes, but this time for three axes, right? Okay, so S, T, and R correspond to X, Y, and Z. And we use GL clamp to edge so that even if the texture coordinates are beyond the valid range of 0 to 1, we will still get the edge value. During rendering, we need to bind the cube map texture. And for that, we need to activate one of the texture units and bind the handle again to the GL texture cube map target. So that was just the cube map texture. But to render the skybox, we also need a couple of shaders as well as a basic mesh for the box. Now you can create the box yourself manually, but I'm a bit lazy, so I have a model file with the vertices of the box that can be loaded using SIMP. Now let's think about how to render the box mesh itself, because there are a few things here that we need to be very careful with. First of all, we want the camera to always be in the center of the box. If we allow the camera to get close to the box faces, it will look like we are getting closer to the sky, which is very unrealistic. The solution is to skip the world transformation of the box. Its position vectors will remain in the -1 to 1 range on all the axes. Instead, we will apply the camera transformation without the translation part. This means that the camera will remain at the origin and the standard camera rotation will be applied on the box. When the camera turns to the left, the box will be rotated to the right. This will maintain the correct orientation between the camera and the skybox. Of course, we will use the same perspective projection matrix as the other objects. Now we can see this part of the code right here. This is the render function for the skybox. It takes the camera as a parameter. Now we don't have a world transformation here, so we start with the view slash camera transformation, which is initialized in a way so that the camera is always at the origin. Okay, so we ignore the position of the camera, but we do use the camera target vector and the up vector. Okay, so these guys, they provide the rotation of the camera, but it has no translation. Next, we initialize the projection matrix as usual with the projection, perspective projection information, which is stored in the camera. And we create a WVP, or in this case, the VP matrix, by multiplying first the view matrix and then the projection matrix. Okay. Next, we set it into the vertex shader and we bind the cube map texture to the first texture unit, and then we render the box mesh itself. Another thing that we need to take care of is backface culling. We usually render only the front faces of a mesh, but in this case, we actually want to render the backfaces of the skybox, which are facing the viewer. This means that we need to reverse backface culling and restore the original setting after rendering the skybox. The last thing that we need to worry about is the rendering order between the skybox and everything else in the frame. Remember, we want the skybox to occupy all the pixels that haven't been touched by the terrain or anything on it. The box itself is very small, and if we don't do anything about it, it will win the depth test against most of the terrain, except perhaps a couple of triangles directly under the camera. One option is to scale up the box so that it will lose the depth test against most of the terrain. But this means that we may be leaving parts of the terrain behind, which should actually be visible, and override them with the skybox. If we're not careful, the skybox may extend beyond the far Z and be dropped completely. The solution is to render the skybox first, while disabling writes to the depth buffer. When the terrain is finally rendered, it always wins the depth test, and the skybox remains only on the pixels untouched by the terrain. But this is bad for performance. The initial render of the skybox will process all the pixels in the frame, because there is nothing there at this point. When the terrain is rendered, many pixels will be overwritten, effectively wasting the GPU cycles that went into rendering the skybox in the first place. The trick is to render the skybox last and make sure it always fails the depth test, so if a pixel is part of the terrain, it will not be processed by the skybox. Remember that the Z component of the position vector undergoes some transformation by the perspective projection matrix, and then divided by W in a pipeline stage called perspective division. If we set Z to be W after transforming the position vector to clip space, then after perspective division it will always be 1, which means it will be behind all the other pixels. Now, there is a caveat here. Since a projected Z of 1 is mapped to the far Z, the skybox is actually clipped away and is not rendered. So for rendering the skybox, we have to change the depth test to less than or equal. Remember to restore the original setting here as well. Okay, so before we wrap up, let's just take a look at the final version of the vertex shader for the skybox technique. As you can see, we have a single input attribute here for the position of the box, and we have a uniform variable for the WVP matrix as usual. We have a single output variable for the textural coordinates, which of course is a VEC3. We transform the position vector using the WVP matrix as usual. And we use the swizzling feature of GLSL to override the Z with the W. Okay, so this is a VEC4, and instead of copying it directly into the GL position, we write XYWW, so this will override the Z. And finally, for the textural coordinates, we just pass through the position unmodified. And that's it. Finally, if you're seeing strange sims along the face of the skybox, you may be running on old hardware, which does not interpolate across cube face boundaries. In this case, try to enable GL Texture Cubemap Seamless, and hopefully it will improve the result. The skybox should now be working correctly. One final touch which you may want to add is a slow rotation around the y-axis, which will make the clouds appear to be moving. Alright guys, thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.